Well, hello there, and welcome to another First Wednesday workshop. And today's First Wednesday workshop is coming to you from both the Financial Services Union and SIPTU. And it is in the spirit of May Day, which we have just celebrated, that the two unions have come together to discuss, to have a discussion about this really important topic of what is it that unions want today? What are the current priorities for trade unions and trade unionists? And for our webinar today, I'm delighted to say that I'm joined in conversation with two of the leading organizers, strategic organizers, organizers on the ground, two of the leading organizers in the Irish trade union movement at the moment. And so let's introduce them. Our first, first of all, we have Garrett Murphy from the Financial Services Union, the FSU. And Garrett is head of industrial relations and campaigning in FSU and very experienced in both industrial relations and collective bargaining, but also in recruiting members to the union and in, crucially, in organizing members in their workplaces and in the sector. And we're also joined by the head of strategic organizing and campaigning in SIPTU. That's my colleague, Dara O'Connor. And Dara is a very experienced on-the-ground organizer and strategic organizer as well. So it's really good to have this conversation with two practitioners. I'm hoping, Gareth, welcome, Dara, welcome. I'm hoping that we have quite a practical conversation today, not so theoretical, but quite practical, based on both of your experience on the ground of meeting workers, talking to workers about joining unions, and actually convincing workers to join unions. So hopefully it's going to be a really interesting discussion. And as an organizer myself, I'm very excited about this conversation, because personally, I feel we don't talk enough in the Irish movement about the actual practice of organizing. So we're going to right that wrong today for the next hour. Okay, so I wanted to just ask you both, maybe go to you first, Gareth. In your experience, why do workers join unions?
Thanks very much to SIPTU for co-hosting this with FSU as well. It's great to have a conversation about why workers are organizing and what future changes can support workers organizing. So I think there's a slight difference in why workers are organizing and then why workers are joining trade unions. So if I deal with the organizing one first, I think organizing tends to the motive and the reason for workers to begin that process of organizing their colleagues and unionizing their workplace. It tends to be really for reasons of respect and dignity and having a voice in their workplace. So it tends to be people who will just see the need for themselves and their colleagues to be able to negotiate and talk to their employer about things that are happening around them. So it could be big changes that are happening. It could be contracts, it could be pay, it could be a range of issues. But what's behind it all is they feel their employer isn't listening to them. They feel they don't have an ability to influence and shape their working environment. And so that tends to be the motives behind the initial group of workers who kind of go, right, we need to talk about some stuff. Why then workers are joining? It's very much the issue of the day. Whatever the current issue that everyone in that workplace is talking about tends to be the basis of all the conversations that are happening. And that tends to be why workers then gravitate towards people who are organizing and unionizing. And it can be something like the non-payment of overtime. It could be a particular grade of role, a challenge to that grade that maybe workers feel their role should be regraded higher. It could be massive issues like pay as a whole in the company. It could even be potentially outsourcing and offshoring. So it's a range of issues from quite small issues, but that are important to the workers collectively, to much larger issues. But I do think there's the behind it all and behind the motives of people really is they want to have a say in their workplace. They want to influence the direction of their workplace, and they want respect and dignity from their employer. I think that then manifests itself in lots of workplace issues.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Dara, does that reflect your experience, or is there anything that you would not agree with there, or that you would want to add to that question of why workers join unions and why do workers organise their workplaces?
No, I think Gareth kind of drew it out quite well. I think the only thing I'd add to it really is that one of the first things we learn as organisers is that we have two ears and one mouth, and that when we go out and we meet with workers, what we don't tell them what their problems are or what their issues should be. We ask them. And that's the way we have genuine conversations about what it's like working in an employment, what are the things they'd like to change, what are the issues that they have. And exactly as Gareth's saying, sometimes it can be really small things that really motivate people. I remember talking to logistics workers, lorry drivers, and they took away the microwave, and they were apoplectic about it. But it tapped into something much, much deeper. It tapped into a sense of how they were recognized or not, or how they weren't valued, because when they went into this horrible, horrible canteen and they took away the one thing that they used every single day. But then, of course, literally upstairs was the plush, furnished, salubrious surroundings for all the office workers. And this real simple thing like the microwave touched a really raw nerve about how they were being treated, how they were being or weren't being respected or recognized for their role within the company. And this is a company that they were spending 8, 10, 12 hours a day working for, right? So they put a lot of their effort and a lot of their life was given over to this company, and they didn't feel they were getting anything out of it.
Well, what both of you have said really resonates with me as well in my experience of organizing workers. And I think sometimes people assume that it is pay, and maybe even pay only, is the reason why people join unions. But yeah, I have to agree with you both. I think it's very much around dignity and respect and voice. And this workshop is part of a whole series of workshops and a campaign that SIPTU is running around workplace democracy. I think most people support that idea of democracy in society. And trade unions really are about bringing democracy to the workplace, aren't they? About giving people, as you said there, Dara, people spend so much of their lives at work. It's not acceptable that you wouldn't have that same right to express yourself and to have a say in the workplace. So I wanted to ask you, might ask you this question first, Dara. In Ireland, and I should have said at the start, both of our unions, the Financial Services Union and SIPTU, are all Island of Ireland unions organising and representing workers in both jurisdictions on the island. But in your practical experience, Dara, and it does vary in the two jurisdictions possibly, what are their impediments, and what are they? What are the blocks to workers joining unions and organising their workplace and having that say in work?
So it really is in that kind of one-to-one conversation where you have deep and honest conversations with workers about what's going on, but also about how they can bring around change. And it's a really big deal for someone to join a union. It means that they're standing up, they want to change things, and they want management to do something different. Management have an incredible amount of power, right? That they particularly non-union or companies and organizations. So to join a union is a really big act. And when you ask people, like, if they're not sure, or, you know, they're kind of hesitant about it, and you ask them straight out, well, look, what is it? Why wouldn't you join up? When you dig down to it, it's fear. That is the biggest impediment to workers joining unions, is fear. They're worried about what their boss is going to think. They're worried about the retribution. They're worried about whether it's going to work or not. And really, that is by far the biggest issue. And I mean, some people might say, well, all you have to do is ask people and they'll join the union. We're that easy. So you could just go out and you'd hire a team of organizers and ask everyone in the country. I don't think you'd actually sign up that many people if you did that. Maybe a few, might be lucky. So really, I think it kind of shows that the we don't have those kind of protections or the supports that unions need to be able to, that workers need to be able to appropriately organize as well. I think that's kind of a big challenge, and I'm sure we'll talk about it later. But I mean, to say one last time, it is fear, and that dynamic, that it's an audacious act sometimes to join a union, and really an act of hope and optimism that you can change things for the better.
Gareth, I put that question to you about impediments or blocks or for workers joining unions or forming a union in their workplace.
Yeah, I mean, I think Dara's hit the nail on the head in the first issue of fear. And I think it's really important that we say that fear is real. It's not perceived. Mm-hmm. And that could sound a little bit negative, but I think as a trade union movement, we have to accept that it is a big step for a worker to join a trade union. It's an even bigger step for a worker to actually seek to organise their colleagues into a trade union, to actively go out and start those conversations.
Yes, it is.
You know, it is. It's real. It's not made up. It's not perceived. And as a trade union movement, we have to do better in institutionally supporting and protecting workers from victimization, which happens and which is real. I think the point around institutional supports and impediments, we might as well say, look, the lack of a legislative framework for trade union recognition in Ireland, in the Republic of Ireland, is an impediment. It's difficult. It's a block. I'm not saying it's the panacea. It certainly isn't the panacea. It doesn't replace, you know, on the ground organizing, but some kind of route to achieve trade union recognition is important. And I can give a practical example of, I won't name the bank, but we were organizing a particular grade of workers in an all-island bank, north and south. And we're making progress in both jurisdictions, workplace committee involved, beginning to recruit and expand into that grade of category. And simply, we got to a point where we could achieve recognition in Northern Ireland because of their legislative framework. And still to this day, we're denied it in the south. And it's the same employer, it's the same grade. We ran the same campaigns, same messaging, everything similar. The difference being we achieved an outcome in the north because of the legislative environment there. We didn't even have to go to tribunal stage. We had enough. The framework was sufficient for the employer to concede it, because they knew ultimately they would if we pushed it the full way. But in the south, we're continuing to struggle, and we'll carry on with the campaign. Hasn't gone away. We're still organizing. But that's an impediment. It you know, every time you organize a group of workers, they say, and they have an idea in their head, if we get to 50%, we'll get it, won't we? Like, lots of people ask this question. And it's a difficult conversation to say, well, actually, there isn't a mechanism. So what we're going to do is we're going to find lots of different points of pressure and leverage, including your potential industrial action. That's got to be a credible threat to actually get the employer to sit down. We have this right now in KBC. You know, it recognizes unions across Europe, including in its home country, Belgium. It's refusing to recognize us here. And it's a real challenge. So I think fear, definitely, as Dara put, is a real emotional issue out there for workers. It's an impediment. But we also have this institutional challenge as well in the Republic of Ireland that we're going to have to address, we're going to have to take on as a trade union movement?
Well, let's move on and talk about that then. It's quite an active and interesting time around the whole issue of trade union recognition, around the whole issue of the Republic of Ireland being so out of step with European peers, with the norm in the European Union, not just the European Union, in the industrialized world in many ways. So there's a lot going on at the moment, and I want to move on now to talk about that. So the last week, we had the Citizens' Assembly on gender equality recommending the establishment of a legal right to collective bargaining. We had the announcement a number of weeks ago of the setting up of a high-level group involving the trade union movement, involving the employer representative body, some academics, and the state government representatives, a high-level group to look at the issue of collective bargaining in Ireland and to look at Ireland's industrial relations framework. And then at a European level, and we've discussed this a number of times in our workshops, but most notably in November, we had a webinar on the draft EU directive, which was, I think, called on minimum wages, now fairer wages, but it also deals with the issue of collective bargaining. So there is a lot happening at the moment. And I want to ask you both, as organizing practitioners, what would you like to see come out of the high-level group? What would you like to see if the government legislates for the Citizens' Assembly recommendation? What would you like to see in practical terms in the transposition of a directive? What are the instruments that would make a real difference to workers who are trying to establish that right to have a voice or a say at work? And in answering it, I'm not looking really for trade union jargon. I don't want to lose the people who are watching the webinar, and not really legislative answers. I want practical answers about what would make a real difference to workers. I'll go to Gareth first on this question.
So no trade union or industrial relations jargon. That's going to be really difficult, Atul. Firstly, I mean, you mentioned the Citizens' Assembly, and I think we have to take the moment to say that's a hugely important outcome from that Citizens' Assembly, to say the legal right to collective bargaining. That's hugely important. And we've got to bear in mind, the Citizens' Assembly have been right on the money society wants and thinks in Ireland. Ireland has become a far more progressive society, and the Citizens' Assembly has reflected that time and time again. It's ahead of what government is. It's ahead of what the state thinks or does or legislates for. The Citizens' Assembly has really reflected how progressive Irish society is. And I think they've done it again this time in saying, I don't know, was it 95% or
96.7
legal right to collective bargaining. So I think that's firstly very, very, very important. But then when we ask ourselves the practical things, so I think unionization levels and union density and collective bargaining coverage and recognition, they are related to how equal a society is. And when you look at wage inequality, you look at skills gaps and things like that, any of those metrics, pension coverage, the greater unionization levels in society, the better and more equal and more fair society are. So if governments are mandated to represent society and to be democratic and to increase equality, I think governments and the state should be mandated to increase unionization levels to support workers organizing. And I think that's the most important thing the state can do. It's the most important thing that this the review of industrial relations and collective bargaining can focus in on, is what institutional supports can we provide for workers organizing? And I think there's some really practical measures, like the right to actually talk about your working conditions with your colleagues. So we've seen lots of new developments within contracts of employment that would include things like non-disclosure agreements, where actually they're saying to people, you can't talk about your pay. You can't talk about issues of harassment and discrimination in the workplace. We're actually barring you from having those conversations. So we have to seriously look at some of those measures. I think workers need the right to talk to their trade union in their workplace, members and non-members. So basically, unions need the right to access workplaces. So a group of workers need to be able to say to me or Dara or you, we'd love to meet you in our canteen at 2 o'clock on Wednesday because we're having some challenges at work. And we need to have the right to go into any workplace and respond to that ask. And I think sometimes people think, oh, well, that's great in a Swedish environment, or that's great in a German environment. A lot of these laws are actually in place in New Zealand, in Australia, you know, in a really diverse range of countries, not necessarily left versus right. They're there in a range of kind of political and economic countries' environments. And I don't see why Ireland can't also legislate and create the institutional supports for workers to join unions. The final point before maybe Dara wants to come in on me, I'd say as well, is we have to look at the issue of making it easier for workers to be union members. And one of those areas around at-source deduction of union subscriptions. And I think there should be legal protections for your union subscription going to the trade union, because time and time again, we see employers using that as a bargaining chip and actually using it as a threat hanging over workers, and use it to victimize workers and trade unions as well. So I think that, again, practical measures like that will make a significant difference and help workers unionize their workplace.
That's really great, Gareth. And I think you did manage to answer it without trade union jargon. So I'm going to put the same challenge now to Darren. Possibly you agree with some or all of what Gareth said, but just that, what would you, Dara, the head of organising in the biggest union in the country, what would you like to see change to make it easier for workers to have a voice at work?
Thanks, Ethel. I do agree with Gareth, absolutely. I mean, a lot of the conversation, when we have this bit of the conversation, a lot of it is focused around trade union recognition or collective bargaining. But I think Gareth really kind of puts the hits the nail on the head, that it's the right to organize. So we have all these, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union and the International Labour Organization. These are all obligations that the Irish state has signed up to. And they give rights to workers to be able to join a union and to be able to negotiate. Right? And we need this review of the systems and structures to be able to give life and give breath to these obligations, that these rights that we're all signed up to, that workers in this country have. But it goes beyond it. And as Gareth is saying, we need a right to organise. So you can have a right to collectively bargain, that's fine. But when you have incredible employer hostility, when they're able to have captive meetings, one-to-ones with workers to put pressure on them, to threaten them with their jobs, right? They are a very effective tactic to try and stop workers from unionizing. So to balance that, to give real life to the right to collective bargaining, you need also these kind of other attached rights, when we want to have the right to recognition, collective bargaining, you need the attached rights of the right to organize, as Gareth was saying, and that's access and neutrality and being able to distribute information and being able to talk to workers, all that good stuff. The other thing I might just add on to it as well is that there's a consequence for not having collective bargaining or not having unions as well. That consequences is low pay, poor conditions, so, you know, a de-skilled and a workforce that doesn't have agency. Now, for workers, that's a horrible place to be in, right? You're struggling to make ends meet. It's very dispiriting. It really kind of grinds people down as well. It's really bad for the state because the state has to put in social supports, you know, in relation to housing and medical cards. It's a huge expense then as well, where because people need additional kind of social subsidies. But it's also bad for business, right? Because you don't have the workers with agency who are able to, who don't have a voice or who have a huge amount to offer about how business can be done better, right? They don't have an avenue to do that, or they've been actively discouraged to speak up and say things. I'm thinking of also within the earlier sector, childcare workers at the moment, low pay means that there's a huge turnover of staff. So that's undermines the sustainability of services. It also undermines the quality that they're trying to deliver for children as well. So like low pay is a massive issue for all the different kind of groups involved in it, not least workers, and collective bargaining and the right to organize are the solution.
Mm-hmm. Perhaps you don't agree with this, or maybe you guys just didn't think of it, but we also need protection against victimization for the workers who lead out on the effort to organize. In any workplace, obviously there are leaders amongst workers, you know, yourselves as organizers. It's often the person who thinks of the birthday cake on somebody's birthday, or they collect the money for the lotto every week. Someone that people turn to for leadership, or someone who's very respected. So it's often those people pick up the phone and ring a union. It's often those people email unions and say, can I talk to somebody? We have issues here. And I'm sure you've both seen it, I have seen it, that those people are mercilessly victimized, sometimes sacked by their employers for showing that kind of leadership. And you know, employers should be delighted that they have that caliber of employee who cares enough about the workplace to want to have a say, to want to have an input. But I would just add to all of the comments that you made, that you have both made, that we would also need really strong protection, stronger than we have, protections against victimization. So we're really getting into it now, aren't we? We're really getting into a conversation that we don't have often enough about actually organizing, signing workers up to unions, why workers want to join unions. Because so often our conversations in the trade union movement are more about industrial relations and collective bargaining. So after people have achieved that right. On previous webinars, I have mentioned the United States because I do think that Irish people, people in Ireland, often assume that the United States is an anti-union setting or not great for workers. And of course, so often we hear that we cannot have collective bargaining and trade union organizing rights in Ireland, similar to other European countries, because we might frighten away American multinationals, or we might frighten away foreign direct investment. I think that's it's an argument that really needs to be challenged, because often those multinationals, as Gareth says, in other jurisdictions are sitting down with unions, bargaining with unions, working through innovation and productivity issues with unions. It's just that because in the Republic of Ireland, they don't have to do that they don't do it. So I think that is a bit of a myth that needs dispelling. But also, you know, it's going to be very interesting if we hear this again now about the Americans won't like it, when the president of America, the president of the United States, is saying regularly and very clearly that he is pro-worker, pro-trade union, And his PRO Act is actually a set of mechanisms that will do exactly what you've been talking about. It's not collective bargaining rights, it's the right to organize. It's facilities and supports for trade unions to actually organize in the United States. So I'm looking forward in some ways to our public debate for the next person to say the Americans won't like it. So we can then say, actually, no, the president of America does like it. He isn't anti-worker and he isn't anti-union. And any comments on that, on the situation in the US?
Yeah, I mean, I just say I think it's very welcome, the support for trade unions and workers organizing that the new president of America has outlined. I think some of the shifts in attitudes are global as well, not just in America. Mm-hmm. I think we're beginning to see a far more confident and far more articulate working class in expressing demands and expressing the desire and to be collectively organized all over the world. I think there was a good victory in IKEA in Asia very recently, and we're seeing workers organizing everywhere. But I think your point about the fear of foreign direct investment is very well made, Ethel, and I think this is another counter argument, because to be honest, like, a lot of the countries where foreign direct investment and multinationals come from already have better labor laws in terms of the right to unionize and the ability to legally enforce an employer to negotiate with you. If you look at Japan, America, Britain, you know, they already, now their systems are not without problems and without faults, as we've seen, unfortunately, in the case of Amazon workers recently, mm-hmm. in America. Mm-hmm. They're not perfect, and none of these are panaceas, but I think Ireland lags behind in terms of institutional support for workers organizing. And again, that's what we need to really focus on. How can the state and institutions of the state actually support workers organizing and mitigate and protect against bad employers and union avoidance and aggressive anti-union tactics? That's just really, really important. And I think any positive development from the US government and the US president is welcome and will help us take on some of the American multinationals in Ireland as well.
Mm-hmm. One of the things I think that's sometimes misinterpreted or miscommunicated in this whole area is that people sometimes mistakenly think that collective bargaining rights and trade union organizing or trade union recognition rights are the same thing. And I just want to explore that with you both a little. So to just elaborate for people that are viewing, the difference between facilitating trade union organizing, trade union recognition, so that area, and collective bargaining. And I would ask you as well, in your answer, to consider this. Collective bargaining can happen at various different levels. So it can happen at firm level, it can happen at the level of an industry, it can happen at sectoral level. So sectoral bargaining, for example, for whole sectors, like Dara mentioned the childcare sector there. We see recently the Minister for Enterprise, Trade and Employment asking the Labour Court to establish a joint labour committee for early years educators. That's sectoral wage bargaining, or registered employment agreements across the construction industry. So at that level. And I think in the trade union movement in Ireland, there's a lot of institutional support for sectoral and industry-wide collective bargaining. But I just wanted to ask you, as organisers, what are the implications of sectoral bargaining for union organizers. And the reason I ask that is, in my experience, and of organizing at a firm level or an industry level, both, in my experience, and I think you both were alluding to this at the start of the conversation, it's actually quite local, everyday workplace issues that are usually the reason why workers join unions. So if we have bargaining going on at the level of a sector or an industry, I want to ask you, does that have an implication for the work that you do in terms of talking to workers about forming a union in their workplace? So I might put that to you, Dara, first.
Yeah, thanks, Ethel. So I think I'm a fan of sectoral bargaining, but I think it's kind of horses for courses. And I think trade unions and workers have to figure out which is the best approach that they need to take. So when I think of sectoral bargaining, what pops into my head is workers who are working for multiple employers scattered all over the country, who are working maybe in small groups or maybe on their own. So you think, well, early years educators or security staff or cleaners. And a sectoral approach is by far the best way to be able to negotiate paying conditions. And that's what the sectoral approach collective bargaining is. It gives the opportunity for workers to be able to negotiate, not consult, not have a say, not to take a survey, but get down to brass tacks and to be able to negotiate pay deals to improve their terms and conditions. So I think absolutely.
So Dari, you're talking there about the industries you mentioned seem to be industries where workers are quite dispersed.
Exactly. That's the key to it, where sectoral bargaining, I think, is most applicable, is in dispersed, isolated kind of workforces. But that said, from a union organizing point of view, just because you establish a JLC doesn't mean you have a union, right? Doesn't mean you're going to be able to do the business on it. And I think that has to be accompanied by quite intense, quite labor intensive work of going out and being able to organize people to ask them to sign up, but then also to be able to build union structures so that you have where workers are able to take democratic decisions, right? And being able to articulate that at a sectoral level. I do think that mightn't be appropriate for everywhere. Absolutely not. And there is that need as well. You can see in larger employments then, where it's like, well, maybe not quite a sectoral, it's just a straight up employer-employee relationship where you need to do the hard graft on the ground. And same again, I think the commonality between the two is having democratic union structures in place where workers are able to decide for themselves what are the issues that they want to tackle and that they have the tools to be able to make that happen. I think that's the commonality between the two. You might kind of take them at two different routes, but at the end of the day, the two things you need is the table to be able to negotiate around and then the strong union of actively engaged workers.
Thanks, Dara. And the same question to you, Gareth, and maybe in your answer, you might just, for people watching, differentiate or explain the difference between that trade union organizing rights and collective bargaining rights. And then maybe a quick view on that issue of the implications of sectoral bargaining for union organizers.
Yeah, thanks, Ethel. And I actually feel slightly relieved that you've asked this question, because I think it's one of the most important debates that we need in the trade union movement. And I'm not sure we talk about it enough. Understanding the difference between recognition and collective bargaining, and understanding, for me most importantly, what is going to help empower workers in their workplaces. That's for me the fundamental goal of the trade union movement. How do we actually support workers organizing? How do we unionize workplaces? How do workers themselves unionize workplaces? That's what we've got to be about. So for me, in one way, we have to strip ourselves back to the very basics as to what we are and then build it up from there. So for me, one of the differences, trade union recognition is effectively the employer saying to that workplace committee, you are legitimately the representatives of staff here. That's powerful. So you have a group of workers that are struggling away to organize their colleagues, to get discussions going about terms and conditions or contracts of employment or grades or the whole range of issues we mentioned earlier. But to get to the point of trade union recognition, that's what the employer says, you're legitimate. I'm going to talk to you about what's happening in work, and you are representing the hundreds or the tens of your colleagues out there. You're a legitimate voice in this workplace. That's trade union recognition for me. And that's hugely important, because when we talk earlier about fear, that's one of the best ways of overcoming fear. Your employer is saying to you, you are a negotiating body for your colleagues, and I'm going to talk to you about it. Now, obviously, you love them to volunteer to do that, but if they don't voluntarily do that, we need to have legal mechanisms, mandatory mechanisms that say you have to talk to those colleagues. So for me, that's what trade union recognition is, and that's really, really important to workplace organizing. Point about collective bargaining, and I'm glad we're having this discussion, because I'm going to slightly disagree with Dara. I don't think on anything significant, but I would be maybe more wary of some of the sectoral, even stroke national, bargaining arrangements around wage and conditions, and what you might describe as wage and condition setting mechanisms that don't facilitate workers organize in workplaces. Because I think the more you remove those items from workplaces, you have a real threat and a danger that you'll actually hollow out the trade union movement over time. And then you will be weaker in 5 years' time when you're sitting down again to talk about sick pay rights or annual leave rights or whatever, or whatever the mechanism or process is. So without getting into the legal mechanisms and how you do those things, I would have a real concern and worry that if we purely look at wage setting mechanisms or bargaining setting mechanisms at a sectoral or national level that don't accommodate workers organizing, you potentially will do more damage to the trade union movement than good. So I think this is a debate we need to have, and we need to think about this. But for me, I'd focus on trade union recognition and support, encouragement, facilities, protections against victimization, the point that you made very well earlier, that facilitate workers to actually unionize.
Okay, I agree with you. This very question is so central to our strength, to our relevancy, to our renewal, to our future, that we really don't take the opportunity often enough to discuss it and explore it. And of course, just before you said it there, Gareth, I was thinking of that whole idea of hollowing out, and unions and the union movement. I think if unions were being reflective and honest, various unions have gone through periods of hollowing out and then have to regroup and refocus and put lots of time and effort into ensuring that the union is vibrant, is participative, is democratic, that it's got great activists who have all the resources that they require to do their work. And I think as organizers, I imagine I'm speaking on all of our behalf here to say that an inadvertently hollowing out our own movement would be a disastrous outcome for our movement. And naming it and being aware of it is a critical step in not allowing it to happen. I think, being aware of the potential of it. So I think it's really, really, really good that we're talking about this. Just wanted to move on to say that it's pretty clear internationally that it's a very vibrant time for the trade union, for working people and for the trade union movement. I think we're seeing workers in industries that we had been told would never want unions, never need unions. Unions are not part of that industry. And some people arguing, you know, unions are a thing of the past. We've enough labor law now, we no longer need unions. So it's really gratifying for us as trade unionists, isn't it, to see these tech workers all over the world organizing, to see a bastion anti-worker corporation like Amazon, where the workers are saying, we're not going to be cowering and afraid and being so courageous to take on that corporation. And that brings me to your own, both of you, your own innovations and contribution in that regard to the Irish movement. So Gareth, you're organizing in a sector which is completely non-union until the financial service, as far as I'm aware, until the financial services union began to speak with gaming workers and organize gaming workers. And of course, Dara, you've just had, you're leading the Big Start campaign in SIPTU to organize early years educators and carers, an industry that was completely non-union, really, apart from maybe a couple of hundred members out of 26,000 workforce until that campaign started. So I want you, please, both of you, I'll go to Gareth first, but talk to us about why it's important that the FSU is going into a new industry. What's it like to go into a new industry? What are you finding with the gaming workers? What's their reaction? Did they come to the union or did the union go to them? So that whole area, Gareth, talk to us about that, please.
Yeah, great. I think there's a global sort of upswing, I think, in workers organizing in unions, and especially in young workers organizing in unions. I think young people are challenging and far more confident in challenging authority, let's say, and also what we might consider the norm. And unfortunately, the norm in the private sector is largely non-union. And I think, thankfully, now workers are beginning to challenge that norm and actually say we need a voice at work and we need to balance the power, I suppose, in work between employers and workers. So the game workers that FSU has been involved in supporting game workers, it really is an international phenomenon as well. So game workers are organizing now all across the world, really. While they would have had some basis in countries like France and some of the Nordic countries, Sweden, I think we're now beginning to see game workers in America and Canada and Britain and Australia and Ireland, the kind of old Anglo cultures, beginning to organize almost at the same time. So it all evolved around 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago, it all kind of started. I think it's really important that all unions look at kind of the new sectors of the economy, because some of the traditional heartlands of unionization have been in decline from an employment position in our economies for decades now. So it's vital that we don't just stay within our traditional areas and create almost a two-tier economy between unionized jobs and non-unionized jobs. It's really important that we make conscious decisions to change our attitudes, change our resourcing, change our whole mentality, that actually these areas are as important as our traditional areas. So it was on the back of some developments internationally in game workers in America, They have games conferences, game developers conference every couple of years. And there was a big debate there about unionization. And these conferences tend to be international. So there was a debate about unionization that occurred in San Francisco. I think it was in late 2018, early 2019. I think I may have the date wrong. But out of that, lots of game workers went home. It was an international conference, went home to their different countries, different areas, and began to think about organizing. And it very much started in this organic, non-union way of workers just beginning to talk. In the case of game workers, they were really talking about something they called crunch, which is basically towards an end of a project or the development of the game, the owner, the publisher is like, this has to be out maybe by the Christmas date. We want to get this game on the market for Christmas. So I don't care what stage you're at. It's got to be out by the 20th of October. So we're ready for the Christmas market. And that means workers there often work crazy hours, 70, 80 hour weeks, you know, missing out on key family time, etc. Often it's unpaid. Sometimes they get time in lieu, but often it's just unpaid, unrewarded. And this was leading to burnout and work-related stress. So these were the issues that workers were really talking about. It was unpaid overtime, but it was more the impact that was having in terms of work-related stress, relationships and families. So initially those discussions occurred online and in workplaces. And then they begin to ask this question of, do we unionize? Is that the next step? So if we're talking ourselves, but we're not happy, and we're actually collectively organizing often in chat rooms and on digital chat boards and things like that. Now do we unionize? And again, I think that conference was really important and people went home thinking now we should unionize. We had developed contacts with Britons in union or unions in Britain who are organizing game workers. And basically one or two came to us through those contacts and said they wanted to take that discussion, online discussion, if you will, a step further into physical getting together and talking about unionization. And as a union, we ourselves had made a strategic decision that we needed to look outside of our traditional banks. So it kind of coincided. So we set up a small branch. We always phrase it, and it's real, it's meaningful, it's not just superficial. We're supporting them organizing. They're organizing their sector. Yeah. We're giving them the resources, the guidance, the expertise, the skills, the facilities, all of that. And when they join us as a union. So we give them the protection of the union. But we're very much helping them to organize themselves. They're driving it in terms of the issues. They have the committee. We help them facilitate the committee, but they very much run it themselves. And they're doing really well. They had a survey that I think got about 15% of the entire sector completed the survey, which was quite significant from zero into getting that kind of number. And they're beginning to join. They've got workplace committees in a number of workplaces, and they have a national committee. We just did the first pay transparency survey. So the lack of transparency in how pay is set is a really big issue. They're not allowed to talk about pay. There's massive ranges from minimum wage jobs up to quite highly paid jobs. But what's really fascinating is everyone wants to unionize across the full spectrum of kind of wage brackets. Everyone is actually committed to unionizing, which is fascinating. And the common theme is a voice at work. They want to talk to their employer about issues. The issues, like I say, might be different. If you're a minimum wage worker, pay is a big issue. It's a huge issue. Of course you want to talk about pay. No one should be on minimum wages in a highly profitable industry like games. But if you're on higher income, it's more about policies that came in that don't work for them, and they had no say over the implementation of the policy. It can be about things like surveillance now, working from home, surveillance technologies. So it's a wide range of issues, but the common thing, again, back to the start of our discussion today, is around voice at work and being able to sit down and talk to the employer. So I take the opportunity just to applaud those workers who are doing this. They're a fantastic bunch. I really enjoy helping them. It's driven by them, and I'm just there to guide and give whatever experience I can and to make it easier for them. And again, I think the more the government can do to make it easier for workers to organize, I think the better for everyone in society.
That's very interesting, Gareth. That was really, really great to hear that story. And yeah, I also want to join with you to congratulate those workers. It's great. Welcome to our movement. Dara, can I go to you and can you talk to us about organizing early years educators and carers? What were the issues that the workers in that sector wanted dealt with? What do they want dealt with now? And how is that all going?
Thanks, Ethel. I might set the scene on it just how it relates to maybe things that are going on in the broader movement as well. So one of the things you hear as a trade unionist is, how do we reach out to younger workers? I always thought you go organize in industries where there's young workers. I think that, to me, the answer is pretty simple. And I think we're doing that within the early years campaign, within the Big Start campaign. That's where a lot of young women work.
Yeah.
And exactly as Gareth is saying, that the trade union movement needs to break new ground into new sectors. That's where younger people are working. That's traditionally where that are non-union, because the world of capitalism isn't static, right? It's dynamic, it changes, and the trade union movement has to respond to that as well. And we have to, you know, that's why there absolutely needs to be putting the resources in to be able to organize new workers. That should be on the top of the agenda of every single union in the country. And I've been really lucky and privileged that the SIPTU have made a really big commitment to the earlier sector. They are sticking with this, and we're going to see it through. And it's great that, you know, we're seeing that kind of really kind of big moves now recently in relation to the JLC being set up. But as you might imagine, like, life on the ground for an early years educator, they're all qualified. A lot of them have degree qualifications. They're very passionate about their work, and they know that the impact that they make is real in the lives of children, right? And definitely we can see loads and loads of research to say that children's social, emotional, cognitive development is benefited from high quality childcare, mm-hmm. right? It's detrimental to children if the quality is bad. So the professionalizing the sector is really, really important. But it is plagued by one big, big problem, and that's low pay. And we do big annual surveys, and that is again and again comes up by a country mile, is number one, pay, and then second is recognition. They don't feel to get the recognition from the state or from society at large. So they're the kind of the key aspects of the campaign. And it is, it kind of puts, maybe sheds light on this kind of the sectoral approach, and why are we taking that in relation to collective bargaining, is because we have 25,000 workers working in 4,500 employments. So when you work it out, right, you're talking to groups of twos and threes, sometimes 20, you know, sometimes there's bigger ones, and we're not going to be able to do, well, I really don't want to start doing 4,500 pay deals, right? We're going to have to figure out a different approach on that. So that's why we're looking at the JLC. But a part of it is that we know that, well, if you want to increase pay for workers, well, where do you get the money from? Because parents who are paying childcare fees, they're not going to, you know, they're already paying $1,000 a month. They don't want to put their hand in their pocket. So ultimately, we have to frame this as it is, as a public service where the state has a really big role to play. And it already does play a big role. It funds, it bankrolls about 70% of the income of early years providers comes from the state. So essentially they have a huge amount of control over it, or theoretically do. But that being said, they still underfund the sector by at least, you know, by about like 50% at least, right? They could easily double it, if not triple it, to get up to the European average. And that gap in funding is filled by low pay, poor conditions and high fees for parents. So we've kind of adopted a twin track approach, is to increase state investment into the sector. We want to make sure that that money is spent effectively to make it affordable and high quality and with decent pay for the workers. And then also we need to have a collective bargaining space where we make, that's really important. So if there is more money going in, it has to, we have to make sure that it goes down to the workers. And I mean, kind of reflecting back on the middle part of the conversation maybe is, how do you make sure that we still have, in that situation, how do you still have empowered, engaged and active workers, right? Mm-hmm. That is like, that's a really, it's hard, like it's hard work. I'm not going to deny it, right? Because it's lots of conversations and the facility to work organizing isn't as big as in kind of big factories or big manufacturing places. But we can do it, and we've built those structures, and the proof is in the pudding, because just before the last election, we were able to mobilize 30,000 people onto the streets with a coalition of other groups as well. And that, I thought, God, if we get 10,000, what a day, right? And we well surpassed that. And it was a huge moment for a couple of reasons. One is that those workers, for the first time, realized the potential power that they had, that the impact that they could have, and an incredible sense on the day. It was electric, right? People just didn't think that it could be done. It also shifted the debate and drove early years and the systemic problems in early years up the political agenda as well, because everyone says, oh, we should do it, right? But it's just that it gets kind of left behind, it kind of falls down the agenda. So that's kind of where we're at the moment. I do think there's a lot of momentum behind trying to reform the sector, to try and make that investment in, and absolutely to drive up the pay of workers to reduce that really high level of turnover that they have. So there's an average staff turnover of 40% in full day care services. So as you can imagine, that's a really disruptive between that relationship between the carer, the educator, and the child. And that's key to the quality piece. So there's a lot of benefits for sorting this out. We just have to keep on the pressure and coming up to the next budget to secure that money, and then do the business at the JLC, and trying to finally for the work of educators to be recognised and rewarded.
Thanks, Dara. And again, to mention the Citizens Assembly, their recommendations on childcare in early years were really progressive, I felt, because they recommended a publicly funded childcare system, not a market-based one, and also a really specific recommendation that the state spend on childcare would triple effectively from 0.37% of GDP, which it is currently, right up to 1% of GDP by 2030. So they're to be commended for their foresight there and their that very progressive recommendation. Well, we've just gone over our time, actually, and I'm really enjoying this conversation. I could sit here for hours talking about union organizing, but unfortunately, we have to finish now because we've gone over an hour. And I just want to thank you both. Thank you, Gareth. Thank you, Dara, for such an engaging conversation. Jargon-free for the most part, I felt. And a really valuable contribution to trade union thinking, I think. Just that point we've made a few times, that we don't take the opportunity often enough in the movement to talk about what I think is the core work of the movement, which is ensuring that workers have the benefit of voice at work, have the benefit of our movement, expanding our movement, bringing our great values and our outcomes to more and more workers. So I think we should do it again. I think we should continue to have these conversations about our strategy and about our organizing practice. So thanks so much to you both. And I'm just going to finish up by saying that our next first Wednesday workshop, the June first Wednesday workshop, is on that issue that both Gareth and Dara have mentioned of low pay. We have a real problem with low pay in this country, and we'll be discussing that topic. And we'll also be discussing the living wage and whether unions should support the idea of a statutory living wage and what implication that has for union organizing, or whether in fact unions should promote the idea of collectively bargained living wages as a suite of measures around worker remuneration and working conditions. So I do hope you'll join us for that, the June 1st Wednesday workshop. And thanks again for watching today. Bye-bye.